281 in your hymnal, 281. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let's all stand together as we sing 281 together on that first. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves.
Singing and welcome to Old Fashioned Sunday. And we are an old fashioned, Bible believing Baptist church. Make no apologies for that. And once a year, we kind of dress the part too. And good to see you here this morning. And we'll have a little parade a little bit later on in the service. And you'll get to see everybody who dressed in their old fashioned duds today. And I appreciate you doing that. Looking forward to a good service together this morning. And good news is, you just sang it. Jesus saves.
Amen.
And if you don't know him as your Savior, you're in the right place this morning to come to know him as your Savior. And thanks for being in church today. Let's bow together and pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for another Lord's Day that you've blessed us with and for the privilege for us to be gathered together here. And Lord, thank you for the old-time religion, as the choir sang about. Lord, thank you for the truth of the gospel that if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved. And Lord, I pray if any in the room today have never accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior and put their faith in him, that today would be the day that they do that. And Lord, I pray that Christ would be lifted up, that he would be exalted and he have preeminence in our service today. And Lord, thank you for your goodness to us and your love for us. May you speak to our hearts today and may your will be done. It's in Christ's name we do ask it. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you may be seated.
I've got that. Pure love in my heart. It is now waiting.
joy in my soul, cause I knew my Lord had control. Well, I knew I was walking in the light, cause I've been on my knees in the night, and I prayed till the Lord gave a sign. And now I'm feeling mighty fine.
Well, I'm feeling mighty fine.
Light that always shines in this heart of mine, in this heart of mine. Heaven on my mind, heaven on my mind. Yes, I'm feeling fine.
I've been
walking with Jesus all the time. We're walking and talking as we climb. We're traveling a world to the sky, where I know I'll live when I die. He's been telling me all about that land, and he tells me that everything is grand, and he said that a home will be mine. And now I'm feeling mighty fine.
Well, I'm feeling mighty fine.
All right, number 477 in your hymnal, 477. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. On that first together, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. On that last, when he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone.
All blessings stand before the throne.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
All right, a few announcements for us now. Listen carefully, if you will. Remember, right after the service today, we'll have dinner over in the fellowship hall, and everyone's invited to stay and enjoy the meal together and some good old-fashioned home-cooked food. Amen. And we'll enjoy that right after the service today, right back in the fellowship hall. And then the regular schedule this evening, 5:30 for our Christian growth class. And we started a lesson last week about the subject of tongues and healing. What about speaking in tongues? What about healing? What about some of those things? And we'll finish that lesson up, Lord willing, tonight, 5:30 in the conference room. Then 6:30 tonight, we'll be right back here for the Sunday night service. And that's a great, great time. Old-fashioned Sunday night. We'll have the kerosene lamps lit, and it'll be a great time together this evening. Have some more quartet music. Wasn't that good this morning? And have some more of that this evening, and we have the Hallelujah offering. How many ever been through a hallelujah offering before? Who hasn't been through a hallelujah offering before? Oh, you're in for a treat tonight. You'll enjoy that. That's a great time. And we'll have a good time together tonight. So hope you plan to come back for the Sunday evening service, 6:30 this evening. All right. Then teenagers, let's see. Next Saturday, the 24th, you're going to have a bonfire at the Reeds from 5:30 to 8:30 p.m. And just make sure you see Brother Andy or Miss Nikki if you're going to come. And they'll make sure they get you down for that. That's next Saturday, the 24th, 5:30 to 8:30. All right, and I'll have a good time there. All right, let's take a moment and welcome any guests we have with us today. We're always pleased when folks will visit with us in the service, and we're delighted to have folks visiting with us today. If you're visiting today and not a member here at Bible Baptist Church, would you honor us just by raising your hand? We can find out who you are and where you're from. Right here, I recognize you. Go ahead and stand up. You're from Friday night. Betty. Great, great. Yeah, yeah, on Friday night.
Bless the Lord.
That's great. Praise the Lord, Patty. Great, good to have you this morning. Thank you for being here. That's wonderful. All right. And got one right here. Your name, sir? You thought you was going to sneak that in, didn't you? Huh? Yeah. You can't sneak it by me. You can't do that, all right? Tell me who you are and where you're from. Alan? Okay, Alan, good to have you this morning. Amen. That's great. You got some children there. Very good. That's great. All right. And Anya, good to see you again this morning. Anna, right? From Angie, that's right. And Angie, it's a Y, right? And good to see you. And Xander, is that right? Good to see you back, all right? They're here Wednesday night. Our Filipino friends are up here in the front row. See them back again. Good to see you folks this morning. God bless you. Thank you for coming back again. Anybody else today? All right. If you received a card and you'll take just a moment and fill that out, we sure would appreciate that. In a little bit, we have the offering. You just drop that card in there if you would. And then keep the pen as our gift to you for coming today. And let's give these folks a warm welcome, shall we?
Was the old fashioned.
whatever that is, where we lost it up here. If you have children in the nursery that are dressed old-fashioned, you can go down and get them. We're going to sing the second stanza, and while we're doing that, get the children together, and then we'll start the parade before we sing the third verse. And Lisa will just play that through. Start down this aisle, come across the front, and go back up this aisle, okay? So get our pictures ready, and she'll get you as you're coming down through, and get you ready to go. And we'll do that after we sing this second stanza, okay? Just remain seated while we sing. Brother Bob?
All right, let's sing that second together. Brethren, see poor sinners round you slumbering on the brink of woe. Death is coming, hell is moving. Can you bear to let them go? See our fathers and our mothers and our children sinking down. Brethren, pray and holy manna will be showered all around. All right, everybody who's dressed old-fashioned, wants to join in the old-fashioned parade, coming around here up the front. And make a loop, start on this side and go that way.
This way and go back that way.
All right. That way we can get the camera and everybody can all be gotten, all right? All right, come on around. Lisa, go ahead.
Sisters, will you join and help us? Moses' sister hated him. Will you help the trembling mourners who are struggling hard with sin? Tell them all about the Savior. Tell them that he will be found. Sisters, pray, and holy manna will be showered all around.
All right, let's sing that last together. Brother Dean, can you give me any more? I'm losing my voice. I really need some help. I appreciate it. There we go. Let's sing that last together. Let us love our God supremely. Let us love each other too. Let us love and pray for sinners till our God makes all things new. Then he'll call us home to heaven. At his table we'll sit down. Christ will gird himself and serve us with sweet manna all around. Very good. Let's go back to 41, if you would. Number 41. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. Let's all stand one more time as we sing number 41. As we begin this song, children, why don't you go on out to Junior Church, which I believe is right across from the nursery today, okay, down in the conference room. So if you'll be dismissed there, let's sing that first together. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. The dying thief rejoiced to see his day, and there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. He washed all my sins away, washed all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, washed all my sins away. Amen. Greet one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing this last stanza together. Thank you. Dear dying lamb, thy precious blood shall never lose its power, till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Be saved to sin no more. Till all the ransomed church of God be saved to sin no more. Let's sing that last all together as you find your seats. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. Let's sing that last together. Then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, lies silent in the grave, lies silent in the grave. When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave.
All right, you may be seated, and we'll get our offering this morning. There's ushers will come. We're ready to receive the offering today. All right. Give us God has blessed and prospered us, and we'll pray and ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. All right. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for the privilege that's ours to give back to you a portion of what you've given to us, and thank you for your goodness to us. We pray now, Lord, you'll bless the gift and giver alike today. And Lord, use the offerings of your people to take care of your work in this place. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take your Bibles this morning for our scripture reading to Hebrews chapter 9, if you would please. Hebrews chapter 9 for our scripture reading. We are going to read verses 11 through 15. Verses 11 through 15 for the scripture this morning. Reading them responsively, as we normally do. We'll begin together on 11, then I'll read 12, and then alternating till we end together on verse 15 of Hebrews chapter 9. And as our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 11 of Hebrews 9. Ready? But Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? And for this cause he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. And let's pray. Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here this morning. And Father, I pray that you will continue to prepare our hearts and that we'll be open and receptive to your word this morning. Thank you for the music we've already been able to hear and to sing this morning. Lord, it's helped us and it's turned our hearts and our minds towards thee. And I pray, Lord, you continue to use the special to that end, to put our heart in tune with your heart, that we might all hear what the Spirit would say to each of us this morning. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Once I wandered in sin's black night, there was no way I could make my wrongs right. Then that old accuser to the Lord did cry, he is a sinner and now he must die. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. Then I heard a voice saying, Father, how go? I'll pay his sin debt in Calvary's flow. I'll bear in my body the marks of the cross to save that child who is sin sick and lost. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. There are those who rely on the works that they do, some men count on the times they pray through. But when the battle's over and my last song is sung, I'll go home through the blood of my Father's precious Son. And it's still the blood that saves from sin. It's still the blood that cleanses within, from the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea. It's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me. From the highest star in heaven to the depths of the sea, it's still the blood of Jesus that brings victory to me.
Amen. Amen. That's good. Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer. And Lord, we do thank you this morning for the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that can cleanse us from all sin. And Lord, I pray that today as we look into your word and we desire to hear from you this morning on this old-fashioned Sunday, that Lord, you'll speak to our hearts and we'll appreciate and be thankful for the blood of Jesus Christ that he shed on the cross for our sins. We love you, and I pray that you'll speak to our hearts today as only you can. Give me your help as I bring the message, please, and please help the folks as they listen today. Keep us from being distracted. Keep us from thinking about other things and letting our mind wander and miss what you have for us. Don't let that happen. Help us to listen on purpose this morning and hang upon every word that you have for us today. And do what only you can do in our midst this morning. And I'll thank you for it. I pray in Christ's name. Amen. The days were long. The nights were filled with nursing sore muscles and trying to reassure one another that hope was not lost. That one day God would surely send a deliverer to replace their sorrow with celebration. Their days were filled with the sounds of a whip cracking on somebody's back, being bossed around, forced labor, shouting by slave masters. Their nights would be spent with their families, eating, spending time with the children, nursing the wounds inflicted by the slave masters during the day. In fact, the workers called them slave drivers, I'm sure. They've been captive for so long, nobody even remotely remembered what it's like to be free. Yet they had hope that one day they may be delivered. But generation after generation had taken place, and they were still slaves in Egypt, mashing mud, water, and straw, until it was pliable enough to be formed into bricks. And when Pharaoh got angry with them, he would take away the straw. At nighttime, they'd gather their children together just before bedtime to say their prayers and try to encourage the little ones. They'd tell their kids that God will one day send a deliverer, that one day God would send someone to release them from their labors and returned them to the land that he promised to our fathers. They'd tell the children stories about Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. But the story they loved to tell and they held on to the most was the story of Joseph. With their kids in their beds and the covers pulled up, mom and dads all over Egypt would tell the story of Joseph, with great hope radiating from their face. They'd tell them how Joseph sold as a slave and went into Egypt. But at the right time, through being put in prison, and at the right time, God elevated him to be next to Pharaoh in command. They told their children that Egypt was not their home, that God in his faithfulness would one day somehow deliver them too. They would pray and they'd ask God to send a deliverer so their children would know the gift of freedom. They asked God to forgive their sin. I believe they asked God to heal their wounds. And they asked God to send a deliverer. For more than 400 years, life went on this way, as they were slaves in the land of Egypt. And then God raised up a deliverer, a man named Moses. And God said, I've seen the affliction of my people and I've come to deliver them. And he appointed Moses to be his mouthpiece. And he said, Moses, you're going to go to Pharaoh and you're going to tell him, let my people go. And he sent plagues into Egypt. And while the plagues troubled the heart of Pharaoh, he hardened his heart. And each time would not allow the children of Israel to leave. Then God told Moses, there's going to be one more plague. It's going to be the death of the firstborn throughout the land of Egypt. And after that night, he told them, you be prepared to go because they're going to want you to leave quickly. Now I want you to go to the book of Exodus chapter 12. Second book of the Bible, Genesis, and then the book of Exodus chapter 12. Here is the instruction that the Lord gives. In verse number 12, God says, I will pass through the land of Egypt this night and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. And the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses whereof ye are, or where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. Each family was instructed they were to take a male lamb, 1 year old, without blemish and without spot. They were to take him from the herd and care for him until the 14th day of the month. And at twilight, on the appointed day, the father of the family was to take the lamb and kill the lamb, catching the blood in a bowl. He would then, the lamb was to be roasted. The blood would be taken, and with some hyssop, it would be applied to the two side posts and the upper door post of their house. The day came, each family was busy killing their prized lamb. Year old, without spot, without blemish. This camp of Hebrews, about 2 million strong, each of them killing a lamb, cooking the lamb, and yet catching the blood, and then smearing the blood on the doorposts and the side posts of their house. I can only imagine what the Egyptians must have thought as they watched this take place. What are the crazy people doing now? What has happened to them? I'm sure they've lost their mind. But after 400 years of slavery, they were praying and hoping God would be true to His word. That the word that Moses had spoken to them about what God was about to do that night would be true. And they would finally be delivered out of the land of Egypt. And I can only think that night as darkness fell, and they huddled in their house waiting for midnight, waiting for the sound of the death angel. They watched as the sky grew darker. The air was ominous. And all of a sudden the death angel from God began to sweep down and move through the land of Egypt. From Pharaoh's palace to the smallest little hut of the slave girl, the death angel searched them all out. At midnight, the Bible says not one Egyptian home was left untouched by the death angel. Look down at verses 29 and 30 of Exodus 12. The Bible says it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians. And there was a great cry in Egypt, for there was not a house where there was not one dead. God was true to His word. He did what He promised. The Hebrews will soon be on their road to freedom and on their road to the promised land that was given to their fathers. The Egyptians were horrified and grief-stricken by the mighty power of God. As they look, and even Pharaoh, with grief and sorrow at his firstborn son lying dead. Had to be an interesting sounds to hear as you hear sounds of wailing and crying and despair, and you hear sounds of shouting and victory and joy, all emanating from the same city. What was it that separated the sounds of joy and the sounds of celebration and the sounds of victory from the sound of sorrow and grief and pain? Did the death angel pass over the houses of the Hebrews and spare their firstborn because they were just better than the Egyptians? No. Slaves and slave masters are both beset by sin. God never said the death angel would pass over the homes of the Hebrews simply because they were Hebrews. He did not say that they'd pass over their homes because of the way they lived or the way the Egyptians lived. He didn't say, I'll pass by the Hebrews because they live in a pretty rough area of town and nobody goes in that area of town. The homes were spared not for any of those reasons, not because of their popularity or their pedigree or their prominence or their bank account. The homes were spared for one reason and one reason only. Was the blood on the doorpost? Was the blood on the doorpost? Did they apply the blood to the doorframe of their house? Nothing but the blood would cause the death angel to spare the firstborn of the land. The death angel, when he came down from heaven that night and began to do his job that God had told him to do and take the lives of the firstborn in every family, listen, he wasn't looking at what kind of car they had in the driveway. It didn't matter if it was a clunker or a Cadillac. He was going to execute God's command for him. He wasn't looking for who lived in the house and who didn't live in the house. He wasn't looking at what kind of clothing they had or they didn't have. He wasn't looking at what kind of position they had in the community or what they didn't have in the community. He wasn't looking at any of those things. He was looking for the blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb. Many in our society today, when they hear the story of that first Passover, and the deliverance of the Hebrew children by applying the blood to the doorpost, that kind of gets repulsive to them. Why blood? Why that's so messy and gory and awful? I mean, couldn't God just say, leave the light on? Couldn't He have said, just hang a plaque over your door? As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. He said, no, you have to have the blood applied. When the death angel came through, he wanted to see that the Hebrews had taken their prized lambs and smeared the blood on the door frames of their house. Now listen, we know that that lamb was foreshadowing the Lamb of God that would come. I don't think they knew that. Not at that time. There's no way they could. They were just doing as Moses instructed them to do. And doing what they were told to do. What they didn't know was that that was a foreshadowing of one day when God would send His Son, His only begotten Son. And that when He came on the scene, John the Baptist would stand to announce Him to those descendants of these Hebrews and say, hey, 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 behold the Lamb of God, which will take away the sin of the world. And He did that as they approached the Passover time. Jesus came as God's Lamb. And He came to die on the cross and shed His blood as a payment for your sin and for mine. You might ask this morning, well, what's so special about blood anyway? You know, blood's pretty special to God. God said this in Deuteronomy 12:23, only be sure that thou eat not the blood, for the blood is the life, and thou mayest not eat the life with the flesh. So God says the life is in the blood. Blood is equivalent to life, and God is the giver of life. That's why killing a baby in the womb is murder, because God gives life. And only God ought to take life. And by the way, now we've got the other end of things. In California, they've passed the law now that it's okay to help somebody die. They get old or they got some bad disease, and now it's legal that you can help them in their life. Listen, when you get away from God, you get away from valuing life. And life is in the blood, God said. Medically speaking, blood is equivalent to life. As we know in our family, you can live without either of your kidneys. You can be on dialysis, and it will do the work of your kidneys. You can live, they say you can live without much of your liver or even much of your lungs. They say you can even live without much of your brain. Well, I can testify to that. In fact, I was reading where doctors at times, where they actually stop someone's heart for several hours as they hook them up to a heart and lung machine and they do a surgery on them. And listen, a man can even live with his heart stopped. But I tell you what man can't live with. They can't live with the blood stopped. You have to keep the blood flowing because the life of the flesh is in the blood. You can't live without blood. Medically speaking, life's in the blood, but theologically speaking, eternal life is in the blood of the Lamb. There's no way to get around it. There's redemption in the blood of the Lamb. There's salvation in the blood of the Lamb of God. There's redemption in the blood of the Lamb of God. There's life in the blood of the Lamb of God. There's forgiveness in the blood of the Lamb of God. Hey, there's joy in the blood of the Lamb of the God. And there's deliverance in the blood of the Lamb of God. Life in Christ, life eternal is found in the blood of the Lamb. I'm glad, I'm thankful for the blood of Jesus Christ. You want to find life and joy and happiness and forgiveness and deliverance? Hey, there's power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Don't forget that. Don't overlook that. Don't leave that behind. There's a trail of blood that starts in the Garden of Eden when God killed the first animals to clothe Adam and Eve after their sin. And it flows all the way through the book to the book of Revelation where those who have been slain for the cause of Jesus Christ, their robes are washed in the blood of Christ. With all the record of the blood of God given to cleanse us from our sin, there's people that still don't want to accept the blood of Christ as a payment for their sin. That's abhorrent to them. It's not politically correct to them to talk about that. That's when you talk about you're one of those folks who believe in the blood, they think, well, you're just one of those uneducated, backward type people that still believe something like that. My friend, it's not, hey, listen, we're not stuck in the 20th century and we're not stuck in the 19th century. We're still stuck in the first century. And we're going to be back where the Bible is still true. A lot of people don't understand the power of the blood of the Lamb or how central the blood of Christ should be in our lives. When we observe the Lord's table and the grape juice that's there. And by the way, it's grape juice, it's not wine, because wine is leaven. Leaven in the Bible is always representative of sin. And so there's no sin in the body of Christ. There's no sin in the blood of Christ. We take that juice and we remind ourselves that His blood was shed for us. We remind ourselves that the Bible says without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. The disciples may not have completely understood that when Christ observed it with them. They'd seen the Passover observed, many of them, ever since they were born. That Passover was commemorating again God's deliverance for them out of the land of Egypt by the blood of the Lamb. Great care was always taken by the Jews to observe that Passover and to observe that deliverance of God. And they're very grateful for what God did for them that day. I think the disciples understood the Passover lamb. I'm not sure how much or when they grasped that they were looking at the Passover lamb of God when they saw Jesus Christ. Because even when Jesus began to say he's going to suffer many things at the hands of the chief priests and be crucified, Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, no, that ain't going to happen. And Jesus had to say, get thee behind me, Satan. Jewish people today observe the Passover all over the world by remembering that God's deliverance and trying to tell their children of that God is their hope for deliverance and one day for salvation. But those of us who know that Christ is our Savior, we would say to them, to our Jewish friends today, we would say to them what John the Baptist said nearly 2,000 years ago. Hey, the Messiah is not yet to come. The Messiah has come. John the Baptist said, it is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. He's here. He's come. And He's paid for our sins. I'd like you to turn back to the book of Hebrews now, if you would, chapter 9, where we started our reading this morning. Notice what the writer of Hebrews says about Jesus Christ. Christ being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater, more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by His own blood. He entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered Himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living and true to serve the living God. He became the sacrifice for our sin. Jesus didn't carry a lamb to sacrifice. He was the lamb and the sacrifice. He didn't just, those priests would offer the lamb and cover the sins of the people for a year. But that's why the writer says Jesus did it once and He obtained eternal salvation for us. How long's eternal, my friend? That is forever. Jesus did it once and it's good forever. Now it makes perfect sense to me, does it not? That you would be saved once and it would be forever. Jesus died once and made the payment once and it's forever. You're saved once and that's forever. It is absolutely true. The writer says the blood of goats and bulls outwardly cleansed the people. They covered the sins of the people outwardly. But listen, here he says the blood of Jesus will cleanse. Notice what he said. It's your conscience. From dead works to serve the living and true God. Hey, the blood of Jesus not just cleansing me outwardly, it's cleansing me inwardly. And I'm changed from the inside out. And that's how God changes people. He changes us from the inside out. And He cleanses us. And those sins, the Bible says, are removed from us forever. God says, your sins and your iniquities will I remember no more. As far as the east is from the west, He separates us from our sin. Never to bring them up again. never to meet up with us again. That's the forgiveness of Christ. Now let me give you three simple thoughts and we'll be done this morning. Three ways which Jesus fulfilled the requirements for the lamb that was offered for the deliverance of God's people. Number one, it was to be a lamb. And Jesus is the Lamb of God. John announced it that day on the shores of Galilee that He's the Lamb of God which would take away the sin of the world. In Revelation 5, you read about Jesus being the Lamb of God. And Jesus as a Lamb took our sins upon Himself. He's the Lamb of God that's worthy to open the scroll, open the book, and break its seals. Jesus was the Lamb that was slain for our redemption. We tell the folks at the minute to prison, and we said it here, that just believing that Jesus died for the sins of the world is just believing a fact of history. You be here this morning and say, yeah, I believe Jesus died for everybody. You can believe that. There are people in hell this morning who believe that. But they're in hell. Because it's not just believing Jesus died for everybody's sins or His blood was shed for the forgiveness of sins. We have to believe He died for my sin. He shed His blood for me. And Christ died for me. And I'll trust Him as my Savior. He's the Lamb of God. He's the Lamb of God. Number two, the Lamb was to be without spot or blemish. Jesus offered Himself to God. He was without spot and without blemish. Notice what Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 1. He said, for as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without spot and without blemish. You think the Hebrews reading that passage would understand what Peter was talking about? They would know exactly what he's talking about. The Bible says Christ is the Lamb of God, and as our high priest, He was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. One of the things you remember, we talk about the old book. I think the choir said something about the old book. You know, your King James Bible says that Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, that whosoever is angry, you should not be angry with your brother without cause. If you are, you're in danger of the judgment. Most of your new Bibles just say you can't be angry or you're in danger of the judgment. It leaves out those two important words, without cause. But then you go over to the other gospel and where Jesus looked upon the money changers and all the money was being exchanged in the temple and He made Himself a cord and a whip. And then He went in and cleaned house. The Bible says He was angry. Now listen to me. If He was angry, did He have a cause? Yes, He did. And that's not a sin. But if you take those two words out, Jesus got angry. He just said over here that if you get angry, you're in danger of judgment. And according to Jesus' own words, He sinned. According to the new versions of the Bible. That's why it's important you have an every word Bible. These are important. Words are important. Words mean things. And Jesus Christ never sinned. He never did anything He shouldn't have done, never said something He shouldn't have said, never thought something He shouldn't have thought. He was absolutely without spot and without blemish. What did Pilate have to say? What did Pilate have to confess? I find no fault in this man. There's nothing that I can find in him. Pilate's wife even tried to warn him, don't have anything to do with them because of the things she suffered in a dream. The Bible says that all of us have sinned. There's nobody here this morning that can say that they've never sinned. There's nobody here today that can stand up and say, I'm without sin. I've never done anything I shouldn't do. I've never said anything I shouldn't say. I've never thought anything I shouldn't think. We would all be guilty. And we all are guilty before God. And Jesus was not guilty, but the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Well, Jesus went to the cross and He paid the wages of sin. He died. Well, if He died and it wasn't for His sins and He was absolutely sinless and without spot, without blemish, then He must have been dying
for our sins. He was dying for our sakes. That's why the Bible says God commended His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He died on our behalf. The songwriter said, He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them His very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. It was a lamb without spot, without blemish. And it was a lamb, number three, to be slain and the blood applied to redeem the lives of the Hebrews. Again, when the death angel passed those houses in Egypt of the Hebrews, he didn't take into consideration who was in the house. All he was looking for was the blood on the doorpost. My friend, when it comes to eternal life, God's not looking at who you are. God's not looking about where you live. God's not looking at who your parents were, your grandparents were, or what your ancestry is. God's not looking at what position you hold or how much is in your bank account or what's sitting in your driveway. God's simply looking at your heart to see if the blood has been applied to the doorposts of your heart. If you have applied the blood of Jesus Christ to you. The Bible says in Colossians 1 verse 19, For it pleased the Father that in Him, that's Christ, should all fullness dwell, and having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself. By Him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, He's made peace through the blood of His cross. That's how you get peace with God. That's how your sins get forgiven. What separates people from God, what gets them away from God is their sin. Well, what's going to take care of that sin? The blood of Christ, the blood of His cross will cleanse that sin away. The Bible says in Galatians 3 and verse 26, For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. You're all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. We're not all God's children. Not until we put our faith in Christ Jesus. We are all God's creation, but we are not all God's children. And you become His child when you put your faith in what Christ has done for you. The only way you stand before God, listen, we just mentioned the fact that Christ took all our sin and He put that sin on Himself. And that day on the cross, He looked up to heaven and He said, God, punish me instead of staying slave. He took all that sin and He put that sin on Himself and He said, God, punish me instead of Bob Reed. He said, God, punish me instead of Bob Wallace. God, punish me in place of put your name there. And God looked down and He punished His Son because He wasn't seeing His Son. He was seeing your sin and my sin. And God says this, God says when we put our faith in what Christ has done for us and we trust Him as our Savior, God says the perfectness of Jesus, the righteousness of Jesus, the sinlessness of Jesus gets put on our account. And when God looks down at me today, He doesn't see Stan Slabaugh. He sees Jesus Christ. That's why the songwriter said, when I stand before the throne, I'll be dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. The only way we'll stand faultless before the throne is when we're dressed in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Nobody will stand before God and say, I deserve to be here. The only way, you know what God's going to do? When you stand before God, God's just going to look at your heart and see if you applied the blood of Jesus Christ to your heart. And are you covered in His righteousness? All of our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, God said. There's no forgiveness without the shedding of blood. The question you have to ask yourself is, what do I do about it? What do I do about it? You ask the average person on the street, or you go take a survey in your family or your neighborhood, and you ask them, how can someone know they have eternal life? And you're liable to get, you ask 10 people, you may get 10 different answers. Everybody's got an opinion. Everybody has something they believe. But God makes it clear. It all comes down to what will you do with Jesus, which is called the Christ. What about the blood? You say, well, I'll just live a good life and do the best you can, treat people right. Then why the blood? Why the death? Why the sacrifice of Jesus? Why would God do that if we can make it on our own? One way. It's only through Jesus. It's only through His blood. We sang it this morning. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath that flood, lose all their guilty stains. I believe it was 1995 at a pastor's conference. I listened to Dr. Curtis Hudson, who at the time was dying of cancer. It was obvious he had lost a lot of weight, was in the final stages of cancer taking his life. Well, taking him from the earth. Can't take your life. He's more alive now than he ever was here. He stood up in front of that great crowd of several thousand at the pastor's conference. And he sang this song. No accompaniment, no instruments. Just a man who everybody knew was dying and could go to meet the Lord any day. And he sang, "The dying thief rejoiced to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Yes, wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away." Ere since by faith I saw the stream, thy flowing wounds supply. Redeeming love has been my theme and shall be till I die. And then he sang this last song with tears streaming down his face, this last stanza. He sang, "When this poor lisping, stammering tongue lies silent in the grave, then in a nobler, sweeter song, I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save. I'll sing thy power to save, than in a nobler, sweeter song. I'll sing thy power to save." Have you plunged under that fountain? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? It's the only way. There's no other way. You only come through Jesus Christ. See, that's pretty old-fashioned. It's as old as the Bible you're holding in your hand is. It's the only way. Thank God for the blood of Jesus Christ. Nothing but the blood. Let's pray. Shall we, Father, add your blessing, please, to this scripture today and to the preaching of your word. Thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that cleanses us from all sin. Thank you that there is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and that sinners plunge beneath that flood will lose all their guilty stains. God, my prayer today is any in this room that has never plunged beneath the flood, that they will ask Christ to be their Savior today. Oh, and that blood, it's still the blood, as they sang about today, that saves from sin. And it'll cleanse away their sin today. And they can receive your gift of eternal life. Please speak to hearts today. And then, Lord, I pray for those in the room of us who have received Christ as our Savior. We'll value and appreciate the sacrifice that was made for us. May we exalt the one who gave himself for us. May we live for the one who died for us. Speak to us this morning. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll pray in just a moment. But I wonder how many here in the room this morning, just now between you and God, I wonder how many folks in this room would say, Pastor, there's a time in my life when I knew that Jesus died and shed His blood for me. And I am trusting Christ alone this morning as my Savior. There's a time when I trusted Him and I asked Jesus to be my Savior. His blood has cleansed me of my sin. And I know that I have the gift of eternal life. Pastor, here's my hand as a testimony. Would you hold it up for a moment that I may see it? Pastor, I know that I'm saved. Amen. You may put them down. I wonder if you're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure. I don't know that I've ever understood that Christ was the Lamb sacrificed for me and that I need to trust Him. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you've never done that. Say, Pastor, I've known about it, but I've never personally trusted Jesus as my Savior. Would you allow me to pray for you this morning? Will not embarrass you, will not call you out, but I'll pray for you. That you'll come to where you'll receive Christ as your Savior. You couldn't raise your hand the first time, but you'll raise it this time. Would you just slip it up and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning? I need to know Christ as my Savior. You couldn't raise it the first time. There were several that didn't. Would you let me pray for you? I don't know if you'll have other opportunities to accept Christ, but I know you have one this morning. I know you'll never have a better opportunity than you have right now. Can I pray for you? I wonder how many believers here this morning would say, Preacher, God has spoken to my heart today about the sacrifice of Jesus, the shedding of His blood for my sin. And Preacher, God has dealt with my heart this morning. Could I pray for you? Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, Preacher, God spoke to me. God bless you. Amen. 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 You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have your invitation. Listen carefully. If you're here today and you've never received Christ as your Savior, after I'm done praying, we'll stand to our feet. The pianist will begin to play. Bob will sing. I'll be down at the front. We have others who've been trained. They've been trained in the Bible how to show you how you can know Christ as your Savior. Why don't you come and take my hand and say, I'd like to receive Christ today. And then let someone with that Bible take you and show you how you can know Jesus. Oh, don't walk out the door without Him. Don't walk out the door today without knowing you're on your way to heaven. Make this the day of your salvation. My friend, none of us are guaranteed tomorrow. Don't boast yourself of tomorrow, the Bible says. You don't know what a day will bring forth. I believe hell's full of people who fully intended to get saved. Just not today. The devil's favorite excuse is for you to wait. Oh yes, get saved. Oh yes, you need to receive Jesus. You just don't have to do it now. But God says do it now. God says don't wait. As soon as I'm done praying and the pianist begins to play, we stand to our feet. Christians will come to pray. Why don't you slip from your seat and meet me at the front? Make today the day of your salvation. Heavenly Father, bless this invitation. Thank you for speaking to hearts this morning. And I'm praying, Lord, for these who are not certain if they die, they'd go to heaven. They've never personally trusted Jesus and His blood shed for them to forgive their sin. May they come and let someone take a Bible and show them how they can receive your gift of eternal life. Father, thank you for speaking to the hearts of believers this morning. And I pray, Lord, that you'd minister to them and bless the decisions that you've spoken to their heart about. I want you to have your will and way now in this invitation. Speak to the hearts of people as only you can and help them respond to what you've told them to do. And I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, you stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Brother Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. I want you to respond to Him this morning, will you? You come. I'll be at the front.
What can wash away my sin?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Is today the day? Today
what
the day you should receive Christ?
Make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Got me on? There we go. We do have a lady being dealt with right now for salvation, and we'll let her have plenty of time to do that and deal with her, and trust that that'll be clear to her this morning. Amen? And that's good. Now, do you need time to go out and get things ready? Go right ahead if you're gonna help do that. Not if you need to sample anything, just if you need to help get things ready, okay? Got to make that clear. I think there is coffee out there, right, Ms. Stiltner? Okay. Don't say amen to coffee. Just say yes. Just say yes. All right. Okay. Well, I'm glad I came today. Hope you're glad you came. And looking forward to a good meal and looking forward to the service tonight. And be a wonderful Sunday night. Old-fashioned Sunday nights are really, really special. And I really look forward to it. Okay. And I'm gonna speak tonight, but I won't tell you what I'm going to preach on. You won't come if I tell you that, so I won't tell you that. So we'll wait. Okay? All right. Vicki, good to see you here this morning. That's you back there, isn't it? Yeah. Good. Got a Sunday off, or you just took one? You did. All right. Amen. It's great. Good to see you here. All right. We had a... What do we have Thursday night? 60? 60 men Thursday night down at CRC. And... had 22 men receive Christ as their Savior. There were 32 brand new guys that were there. One fella had been there for his third week and just gave a wonderful testimony about what God's done in just 3 short weeks. But he was telling me afterwards, it was about 3 weeks ago, he said, drugs was his issue. And he said, I really had a hard night, a lot of cravings and such. And he said, I woke up the next morning, it was a Thursday, and he said, and a pass to come to Reformers Unanimous was in my box. He said, I never put in for that. There was, so I came. And God, he's accepted Christ, and he's working the program, and just a wonderful thing. God's just, it's just amazing what's going on. And then we had 13 at London yesterday, and 18 with us counted in. The 12 guys were there who've been there before. There was only one first-timer who came at the very, towards the third talk. And of those 12 guys who are there, I think 8 of them got certificates there, which means they're working through their material and going through it. They're really, really good guys. I wish you could hear the testimonies of these guys. By the way, you pray for a fella, Ahmad, A-H-M-A-D, Martin. Ahmad Martin. He is a fellow who went through the program at CRC and completed it, by the way. Was one of our graduates. And he gets out tomorrow. And he's coming here. He doesn't have anywhere to go. And he doesn't want to go back to the old crowd and the old place and get around the old friends. So he wants to start fresh. And so he's getting dropped off here at our church sometime tomorrow, whenever the release happens. And so pray that we'll know. Say, what are you going to do? I have no idea. We're praying and seeing what the Lord will have. And I told him the same thing. I said, great opportunity to see what God's going to do and see what he'll take, what direction he'll go. But I want to help the man and help him live for the Lord. And good guy. And this is just, I really think this is probably just the beginning. There are going to be others that are going to come out and they're going to want to help and want to relocate to serve the Lord here. And we want to try to help them do that. Amen? So it's a great thing. God's doing good things. All right, let's stand together. We'll have prayer, we'll sing, and we'll go eat some food, all right? Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us, and thank you for speaking to our hearts today. Lord, I do pray for this lady as she's being dealt with now. Open her heart, open her understanding, and may she receive Christ as her Savior today. And then, Father, we pray for the food, that you'll strengthen us and nourish us with it. Bless our conversation over the food today. Thank you for the many hands that prepared something for the meal this afternoon. Now, Lord, give us a good afternoon. Prepare us what you have for us tonight and bring us back safely for our evening service. And we pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Let's sing it together. Brother Bob? Oh, wait a minute. Hold on. You're done. Okay. What do we have? We have a card. Okay. Betty Griffin. Betty, you received Christ as your Savior today. Congratulations. God bless you. That's wonderful. We're pleased. We'll let you get the rest of that information. But a congratulations, Betty. Praise the Lord. We'll get that filled out. All right. Now we'll sing together. Brother Bob.
I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood, joint heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.